Okay, we might as well get rolling here. And this video is following up on the experience I had yesterday at the end of the video, where I was saying, space out in super smooth space, inherent spaciousness or spaciousness. Space out in superlative infallible sameness. Space out. So I was saying this over and over, and what did that happen? I spaced out in superlative infallible sameness, in a superbly smooth or super smooth spaciousness. And so I just stayed with the practice of wowing the whole thing and observing it and just staying in the wow. Don't follow any reactions. Don't put a framework of reactions or concepts around it at all. Just stay in the wow. And I just stayed in the wow and just said, okay, like a movie, let's just experience this. Let's watch it and see what happens. And so I did that. And so I can report back to you the significance of this now and what happened. It's very significant, to say the least. And so what is today? July, I think it's the 7th. So welcome to July 7th, 2016. We're really closing in on the good time, the best of times and the worst of times, actually. This is what we're getting towards. So if we're oriented towards the best of times, hey, it's great. It's absolutely great. We can start off with the hors d'oeuvre, nice tasty hors d'oeuvre of saying that spirituality and materiality are two sides of the same coin of self-delusion. It's egoic delusion. Spirituality and materiality are two sides of the exact same coin of egoic self-delusion, egoic arrogance, actually. Amazing, huh? It's true. It's absolutely true. So try that for an hors d'oeuvre and just let it sit there. You just say, okay, and then we'll just move on to the next course. The discipline that we have here is the right discipline. It's the same discipline that's been used throughout history, actually. This is what I'm noticing. And so when this experience happened, I just let it happen. I'm just sitting there in closed my eyes and just observed and just went along. Wow. Okay. Just wow. That's it. Did not elaborate upon it at all. And so paid attention. And so I was in that state for quite some time. My body felt like a statue, really. I was aware of my body as just sort of a one feeling in the body of just kind of like inert. Sort of just this inert, like a stone or a statue, kind of. And I became aware of what you would say is space, mind, the spacious nature of mind. It was dawning on me. I just said, okay, wow. I just stayed in the wow, that's all. Didn't say, oh my gosh, I got, no, just wow. Oh, it's just, it's, no, just wow. Wow. Just notice it. Just wow. No other reaction. Try not to go anywhere with it. Don't put a framework of labels around it, a storybook around it, a memory around it, any sort of, no, just wow. I'm not trying to create a memory or anything in the future. No side trips. Just stayed with it like that. And so long story short, I said, well, at some point I need to come out of this. I'm not really sure how to come out of it, because there's nothing in what I was experiencing in my body to bring me out of it, so to speak. I didn't really want to come out of it, but I just said, well, pragmatically, there will be I will come out of it, and I'll have to go function and go to sleep and all this stuff. So I observed my mind, what was taking place in the inner landscape of my mind. The mind. And in hindsight, I can say this, that what happened was an experience began to unfold in the mind where it seems like that the feeling of spaciousness, the mind of spaciousness, sort of began to now be the sky, and then the sky kind of unfolded like a millipede or a centipede or something, where all these like a rubber carpet, some sort of carpet unfolding, and there's millions of these little pads, kind of, that sort of, as it unfolded, they kind of popped up a little bit from the carpet, and this sort of spread out, and now I felt like there was a world there with all this separation and diversity and everything like that. And I said, "Well, what happened to the spaciousness? It didn't seem spacious anymore. It seemed all this form, all these different forms that were all part of this one carpet, but it's kind of like these little pads, like." So it seems like they were separate, but the base was all joined to the surface of this tapestry, sort of this big large tapestry. So sort of this huge tapestry suddenly just appeared and began to unfold. And this unfolding of this tapestry had all this form that was all still attached to the tapestry, but it all seemed kind of separate from one another. And then my attention was on that. I said, "Hey, wait a minute!" And then it seemed like the sky was up here, and then the form was here, and then I began to lose this feeling of mind of spaciousness. But I just kept wowing this. I said, "Okay, just wow. Okay, this is what's happening now in my inner landscape." Didn't try to judge it, think about it, or anything. Just be aware of it, and neutral observer, kind of just wow it. Classic meditation technique, right? Absolutely. And so, then I said, "But I'm still in this sort of a statue-like condition where I don't really feel like moving at all." And so what I did then, I couldn't figure out what do I do? What's the right thing to do here? What I did, I had my hands were just folded, by my knees here. And what I just did ultimately was I just began to wiggle my thumbs a little bit. I just began to just wiggle my thumbs a little bit. Then a little bit more, and then wiggle my fingers like this. And then my eyes kind of gradually, I was opening my eyes and doing that, and then just came out of it smoothly and easily, just like that. Just by kind of wiggling my thumbs. I don't know if you can see it. Yeah, just wiggle the thumbs a little bit, and then kind of the fingers a little bit. So it started with just the tips of my thumbs a little bit, then the full thumb, and then the fingers, and then the hands, and then just came out of it nice and smooth and easily. And then just wow, okay, wow. Then just went about the rest of the evening, and then today, getting up, everything. It just took everything in stride. Didn't think about it. I just kept wowing it. Okay, wow. Went back to Facebook, posted a lot of pictures and graphics. So then today, I'm looking back on it, and I said, "Okay, so." What's the key here? Why didn't I stay? How do you stay in the spaciousness? How do you stay? Now, I thought that somehow I lost it and some mistake or what happened, but then I realized, no, that I wanted to come out of it. So that's when I wanted to come out of it, saying, "Okay, I've been in it a pretty long time. Let's just come out of it." That's when this tapestry unfolded that took me out of it, actually. So I realized this responded to my own desire, and this is what our mind does to take us out of this condition. So I became aware of what we do when we want to bring ourselves out of the condition of experiencing pure spaciousness. It wasn't something that happened from separate from me. It was my own desire to come out of it that immediately gave this imagery, this sort of dynamic imagery feeling also that of diversity and separation and all that. Now here's where it gets very interesting. Okay. What we do to trick ourselves. Here's an example. Let's say we're at the beach and we're sitting on the beach and we're watching the ocean. It's a very calm, peaceful day, just glassy, calm water. We're just looking at the ocean. It's so nice. Now let us say that there were maybe like two pillars on either side, and then a cross beam, a header across the two pillars. And from that cross beam, suddenly a screen dropped down. At the same time the screen dropped down, a projector behind us projected a moving picture of the ocean upon it. And it happens like that. As quick as a snapping your fingers, the screen and the projection upon the screen is there. And it's showing you the exact same thing as what you were looking at, the ocean. So let's say you're distracted for a moment, or it happens so quickly, you say, well, what happened? Did something happen? Oh no, the ocean. Still the ocean there. Okay, nothing happened. But actually, what is happening is you're now viewing not the ocean, but a screen with the ocean, of a imagery of the ocean projected upon that screen. You're not viewing the ocean anymore. Okay, are you getting what I'm saying? This is what happened. Is in my mind, I was viewing this intrinsic spaciousness. I was experiencing intrinsic spaciousness. As soon as I wanted to come out of it, what happened was, just like that, I was now viewing an image of intrinsic spaciousness instead of the actual intrinsic spaciousness, an image of it. Imagery, so to speak, mental imagery. And then that mental imagery began to be played with. All right, jet now. So let's go back to the ocean. You're watching ocean. The screen drops and the projection of the ocean, and you think, oh, I'm still watching the ocean. And then let's say on the screen, the water starts being choppy, and it looks like it's windy, and so wow, okay, it's getting stormy, a little windy here. Okay, and then let's say it starts becoming stormy, and clouds come in, dark clouds come in. And the ocean's really tossing, and big waves are pounding, and you're just like, oh my gosh. And you're all like nervous. You say, wow, it's a terrible tempest. You know, so what happened to my calm, peaceful ocean? Well, you're not really seeing the ocean. Behind the screen, the ocean is still completely peaceful and calm. You're watching a screen with a movie being projected upon it. And that movie, a movie, of course, we can alter, what we can project whatever we want upon an imagery, right? So we're projecting a storm, but the storm is unreal. It's just an imagery being projected on a screen. So you can manipulate it any way you want to. So what I saw in this experience was the intrinsic spaciousness, mind is intrinsic spaciousness. And then suddenly I see this tapestry unfolding, like it's fragmenting into form also. And it says now in spaciousness and then form, time, space, process, and form. I say, wow, what happened? But I really wasn't seeing intrinsic spaciousness. I was seeing an image, imagery of it, an image of it, a concept, an image of it. And that image is being manipulated. But intrinsic spaciousness was actually, nothing was changing in it at all. I was watching a screen when and the imagery was being manipulated on the screen by my mind, you see? So just wow this, hearing this, and just say wow. This is the explanation I got today when I was praying for an answer. This is the explanation I got, and I said, ah, yeah. And what I was told by the grace of God in the insight is I had read a quote by Longchenpa yesterday that Buddha and sentient beings are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. He was emphasizing this. I was reading Longchenpa yesterday in order to make some graphics and post them. Buddha and sentient beings are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. What is very important is to realize that this imagery, this inner mental imagery, that too is simply arising in intrinsic spaciousness. So the concept of intrinsic spaciousness is the same as the concept of non-intrinsic spaciousness within intrinsic spaciousness. It's the same. There's no difference. So the thought of Buddha and the thought of non-Buddha are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. The thought of Buddha mind and the thought of not non-Buddha mind are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. So All imagery is the same in intrinsic spaciousness. Even the idea of intrinsic spaciousness is the same as the idea of form in intrinsic spaciousness. There's no difference. It's all superlative, infallible sameness. So this is what Longchenpa and the Dharma kings are getting at. This is what they're all getting at. All of them are getting at the very same key recognition. So I say, wow. Wow. Okay. So take it in stride. Just okay. So just wowing it. So I'm just still walking along here with this recognition. And just wow. That's all I do with it. Don't try to project in the future. Don't make a memory of it so you can, you know, store it somewhere. Don't try to store it anywhere. Just wow it. So I thought something was happening within intrinsic spaciousness. A form was arising. It wasn't. It was just imagery. But the intrinsic spaciousness that I thought I was seeing was also imagery that had been superimposed upon real intrinsic spaciousness. And since I took it to be real, I thought the form was then something that was happening to it, you see. It seemed like something was happening to it. But it was only something happening to an image of intrinsic spaciousness. Nothing was happening to the actual intrinsic spaciousness. So this is the entire power shift that we need to make. Gotta be cool now, power shift, here we go. From Shutdown, the Beach Boys. Gotta be cool now, power shift, here we go. This is the power shift, is seeing this, seeing it. Say, okay, wow. Now, it's very interesting that yesterday I decided to appeal to Padmasambhava, Guru Rinpoche, which he's really the Buddha of Tibetan Buddhism, so to speak. He's the central figure of Tibetan Buddhism, actually. And there's a statue made of him. That there's a picture on Facebook, and I posted on my shared on my Facebook page, and it's the famous. I've seen it before, and it's just like wow. I always looked at it and said, it's kind of scary. He looks like he's a little bit cuckoo or something. I don't know. But I looked at it again yesterday, and then I saw something, and I just said, wow. Extremely profound. I just said, oh. And it my perception of it shifted, and it's really quite extraordinary. So, for some reason, I began to appeal to Padmasambhava. I said, "We need all the help we can get, Padmasambhava. You know, let's do your Dharma King stuff for us. We really are calling upon all Dharma Kings, all help we can get." And the day ended up being maybe the most extraordinary day I've ever had spiritually. The quality of the breakthroughs was simply extraordinary. Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa. During the day, I was chanting his name and Longchenpa's name and appealing to him. And I had some mantra, I can't remember what it was, but it was a good one. So I try to make up these beautiful mantras now, they come to me. So it's very auspicious to be seeing this. It's very auspicious. It's central. It's very, very central. And I've seen many other breakthroughs in the last 24 hours. And again, saying that spirituality and materialism are exactly the same, actually. There's no difference at all. Spirituality is the image of intrinsic spaciousness, and materiality is the image of the world, so form, time, space, process, and form. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to get on the good side of this image. We're manipulating the imagery. Okay, this is the mistake. Now, Longchenpa said something also. He says, just one insight cuts through it all. Just one insight settles it all. He says, just one insight settles it all. Just one insight settles it all. And I saw what he was talking about. Is when you see it's just all imagery. And there's no need to make any, there's no differentiation. It's all the same in inherent spaciousness. That settles it all. One insight settles it all. Now, so we're bringing in Padmasambhava, the lotus-born one. This is, the Tibetans regard him as the true heavyweight. And we're bringing him in here to the West right now. I'm bringing him in. And this is a very profound step to take. Because, wow, indeed he is quite a heavyweight. Historically, he is just, you can't get more extraordinary, really, than Padmasambhava. You can't get more miraculous than Padmasambhava. He's so off the charts. It's virtually unfathomable. But I feel comfortable bringing him in, calling him in. It's time. It's your time now. It's your time. What a great feeling, huh? Padmasambhava Longchenpa. Padmasambhava was seen to appear to Longchenpa and then to merge into him. So Longchenpa was also the embodiment of various, you know, great deity wisdom figures, so to speak, all embodied in Longchenpa. But we'll call both of them in. Call both of them in, right? Yeah. So this is, you know, if there's a fire, you're bringing in the powerful fire hydrant right now. You're hooking up the big fire hydrant. The big hose and the big fire hydrant, and wow, you're gonna put some heavy water on that fire of the delusion of this world. You're gonna put it out. So I went into this non-dual sort of consciousness, and I wasn't so interested in how I got into it. I was much more interested in just observing, and then how did I leave it? Okay, so that's the important thing. Be aware of how you left it, because that's how we delude ourselves. I said, oh, yeah, it's there. Okay, I see it's there. I was aware, oh, definitely it's there. I said, okay, it's easy to get into it. But how in the world did I ever leave it in the first place is my question. And so now we're seeing, you know, how we have deluded ourselves through images, imagery, concepts that make a concept of intrinsic spaciousness, and then manipulate that concept as if something is happening to it, where it's now part intrinsic spaciousness and part form and part non-intrinsic spaciousness. And then we try to what? Get that part of it, that spaciousness, and try to abide in that. And this is called spirituality. This is called spirituality. Spirituality, again, is totally delusional, totally dualistic. It really is. And I'm seeing this now. It's very easy for me to see it now. It's like, wow. I always knew it was, but now I'm seeing why is it? It's like trying to get on the this image, and you're trying to migrate into the good part of the image, you know? Not realizing it's just an image, taking it that it's real spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, whereas in fact it's just an image of it. It's like an image of water, you know. Try, oh, I'm now in the area of the image of the water. My thirst is going to be quenched, and it's not quenched, is it? Spirituality has never quenched anybody's thirst. Spiritual thirst, not at all. They're still thirsty. This is what I've observed in this world. All these spiritual people, these spiritualized people, you look at them at the end of their lives, through their lives, and you realize they're just as thirsty as ever. And they try to be good soldiers about it and die a good death and hope that they're going to migrate to even better land, and when they die, a better ass area of the image. So we're just trying to find areas of an image. But the whole, of course, image, illusion is vulnerable to illusion. Totally vulnerable to it, isn't it? Because our mind just decides, well, this area now is now, you know, hellish realm. Oh, it's a hellish realm suddenly. Oh my gosh, what happened to my nice, peaceful, you know, oasis, image of an oasis here? And it's gone. So we still feel insecure and jittery, like we don't quite have it yet. We're not really haven't been able to secure it. So spirituality's attempt to secure a secure area of an imagery of an illusion. But illusions are completely vulnerable to, you know, any other illusion, any other imagery we want to imagine, pops up immediately. So spirituality and materiality together, combined, form the delusion. So neither one is right. So don't go indulging in materiality. But however, a little caveat here. Don't go indulging in either. But if you have a tendency to get caught up in spirituality, it's better to be a little bit material in your life to avoid that. Okay, so that's kind of what I do. I don't hang out with spiritual people, you know, in life, in existence, in this dream. Like I said, I try to, if I do something, I'll go play golf or something where those are just, you know, materialistic people, you know, with their nice cars and their money, and you dress up very conservative and clean cut and stuff. And so that keeps me away from spirituality, which is helpful, very helpful for me. If some are very materialistic, it might be good to get into spirituality a little bit, to stay away from materialism. If that's your basic orientation of delusion is materiality, then it's good. So a lot of people who are into spirituality are actually very materialistic. And some people who are into materiality are actually, you know, very early their orientation toward spirituality. And so they're kind of trying to stay away from spirituality. Because they know that there's something that just isn't quite right. It doesn't quite work for me. So it's kind of a funny dance we have going in the world, isn't it? You could see a lot of the spiritual people, actually, you could see that they're actually very materialistic. And later on in life, you might see somebody who used to be really sort of act like really spiritual, and they're just totally into materialism. You know, just got a really nice home and luxury this, luxury that. I got my nice garden. I'm just, you know, I'm making like my beautiful space here. You know, I'm really into security of money and all this. You know, you see, wow, they're just super materialist actually. And sometimes you see materialists that later on in life, they're just like Dharma bums or something. They, you know, they're just very, they turn into hippie Dharma bums. They're very spiritualized. So they were just overcompensating the other way to prevent themselves from getting too hooked on either way. So it's important not to get hooked on either one of those. So some may be being spiritual to avoid being hooked in too much materiality, and some may be material to avoid being hooked in too much spirituality. Because both of those form just one delusion. And this is what is keeping us from experiencing what we really are and what really is, the isness. And spirituality pursues happiness. I want to be happy, I want to try to find, but happiness is always associated with an image, actually. Reality is bliss. It's not happiness. Happiness is always dualistic, associated with illusion, with image. And so spirituality is trying to be more peaceful, more relaxed, more happy, more loving, more kind. That's all delusion. The real feeling of reality is just this supremely smooth, spaced out, inherent spaciousness. This superlative infallible sameness, the superlative infallible sameness. That's actually reality. This is a very different feel to it than what spirituality is always after. Spirituality is always after some condition, some feeling, some state, something. It's always, I was looking yesterday of some great leader of the 60s, spiritual leader, and what he has to say now, and it was so sad because he's just still completely dualistic and pursuing happiness and compassion and love for people and blah 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 blah. Did not make it to see through the situation at all. And this is typical. This is typical here. I read something also by George Gurdjieff. Said he, in his, you know, his look, way of looking at the world and his experience, he said, it's only the very, very determined and intrepid and determined who are actually going to make it. There's a certain type, he says, that can make it, but the others, they don't make it. He's probably right about that. Because we really fool ourselves. And of course, our continuity fear keeps us searching within this imagery, this image of intrinsic space. Oh, I see it's over there, it's over here, maybe it's here. Even trying to find here is just also total delusion. Nowhere is here. You know, no here is here. No path is the path. No structure is the structure. No way is the way. No way is the way. So trying to find the now, that's also total delusion, actually. Because you're finding an image of the now. So where in this image of existence is the now? Can I, you know? So we're seeking, then we meditate, and Buddha found this out. He said, you're meditating to try and find this place in the image of where intrinsic spaciousness is in the image of intrinsic spaciousness. And so you go through all these trance states, etc. And then you think the reason why you can't find it is the body. The body's to blame why you can't find intrinsic spaciousness within an image of intrinsic spaciousness. So blame the body. Finally he said, that doesn't work either. And then he saw, oh, it's all an image. All this is just an image. We're just deceiving ourselves. And the image itself is abiding in intrinsic spaciousness. Completely. So the image of intrinsic spaciousness is abiding intrinsic spaciousness just as much as an image of form is abiding in intrinsic spaciousness. There's no difference. It's absolutely the same. So this is what these Dharma kings are getting at. So we're getting what they're getting at. We understand their focus. Say, aha, okay. So then they just wow it. They say, wow, okay. Good timing. One thing I always have is good timing. I don't like it. I'd rather do it ahead of time. Maybe it's just it's more adventurous and fun to, you know, barely, you know, win at the end, so to speak. It seems like a very dramatic thing, and yeah, we like adventure, and so maybe it's just that playing out. It's my own sense of adventurousness. I tend to bring it in right at the wire, you know, just at the right time, so to speak. It's just before, just as you have to get it, I get it. It's always been that way. Well, it's better than not getting it, isn't it? But all homage to those who get it ahead of time and help us out. So, here we are. And we're just this beautiful evening. We're drunk on the weather here in California. We're perpetually drunk here on the weather, actually. It never ends. We're kind of stunned by it, actually. It's pretty interesting. The weather tends to stun us here. Maybe that's why you feel tired. Maybe other places you feel much more energetic because you're not really focusing on the weather. The weather, it's lousy, whatever. I got to do something to feel good. Here in California, you don't need to do anything to feel good. You just go outside. and just like, wow. Just drink in the air. Just, ah, wow. Take another hit of fresh air in California. Sunshine, indeed. It's all you need. And so we feel like, oh, I don't really need to do anything. I feel great in terms, you know, in a dualistic way, but it it might breed a sort of kind of laziness, actually, indolence here. Yeah, I think it might. Yeah, but it's helpful for meditation. I don't need to do anything or go anywhere. I can just sit right here. I feel everything's fine. Right? It's just perfect. Wherever I am, it just feels perfect. So why don't I just sit here and focus in on the, what we're, you know, what's clarifications here. So there is that benefit to it, I would say. There really is. In other places, you might feel I really need to be industrious and doing things and constantly doing things to feel like feel good about myself. But now here, just it's like you're embraced by this beautiful atmosphere. You just roll out of bed and you just say, "Wow, what's the day gonna be like today? How nice! Oh, today was just wow! Just this beautiful, cool breeze in the morning on the in the freshness and it's just." You just want to say to people, "Wow, what a day, huh?" I do, and they say, "Yeah, wow." I said, "Just enjoy it." And they say, "Oh yeah, it's just this California dream." And they say, "Yes, it is. It's like it's almost the weather's so nice, it's like a dream, actually." It's true. It's really true. I've been in living it my entire life here in California, other than spent a couple of school years in Hawaii. Actually, before I went to school, so I was just hanging out in the street, playing with leaves and ants, and sitting in the rain and walking around, and you know, it was pretty idyllic back then in the late 50s in Hawaii. I just pick leaves and look at all the beautiful plants and spiders and insects and just playing outdoors all day long, you know, just in shorts and barefoot. And go to the beach and walk on the sand and build sand castles and play in the ocean, and that was it. That's all I did there. You know, it wasn't going to school. There was no preschool back then, so I was like, from age like 2 and a half to 4 and a half or something like that. We spent most of that time in Hawaii. No school, no preschool. I started school in kindergarten. I was about six, actually, I think. Maybe five. But nowadays it's amazing. It's just incredible. People say, "Oh yeah, my kid's you know, four." And oh yeah, they're busy with preschool, four. Some maybe some even younger than that, but certainly by four. I really don't think I started kindergarten. Maybe I was 6 years old, something like that. I don't know. But nowadays, wow, this is just insane. So it gave you a time to really appreciate kind of nature and just taking it easy in nature. I think it's very important for children to not feel pressured into school too early, actually. So I had this love of beauty and it was in me that was there was something was stronger than schooling was already in me, kind of. It was stronger than schooling. There's sort of this vast feeling of intrinsic spaciousness and ornamentation, the beautiful ornamentation in it. So when school came along, I hated it. I really hated school. I said, "What is this? This is a hideous intrusion upon my bliss, you know? Hideous intrusion upon my bliss." So I was a very mischievous in school because I was trying to sabotage. I didn't like it. I didn't like it. I kept trying to sabotage the teacher and, you know, collapse the schooling and the recess everybody. You know? So it'd be you know, I was a troublemaker. But pretty much, they'd show me they didn't like that, so I kind of just kept to myself, kind of brooded. I didn't like. You know, I hated being at school. Getting out of school was wonderful. I didn't really socialize much because. You know, I wasn't interested in existence, actually. I was more in kind of like this beautiful space, mental space. So existence didn't really interest me. And I was aware of all the subtle forms too. I was aware of subtle spiritual forms, etheric forms, and everything. I saw light around everything, and I was when I started drawing pictures, people said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm drawing." They said, "You're very imaginative." I said, "Well, I don't understand what you're talking about." said, well, you're putting all these lines around everything and rays going off of everything. And they said, where'd you come up with that? That's very unique. Most kids don't come up with that. And I was like, so they thought I was some artistic genius or something. No, I was just drawing what I was seeing. I said, what are you talking about? I'm just depicting here, drawing what I see. They thought I was just some sort of, genius artist who, another Picasso or something, to drawing, all this stuff that isn't there, and thought I was super imaginative. And I was just drawing what I was seeing. So I said, I want to get back to this. Schooling really is terrible. What is it, Ramana said? Schooling is learned ignorance. Indeed it is. Indeed it is. It very much is. They're teaching us, how do you get to a nice place on this image? This image. How do we get to a nice place? And and then people in the world said, well, spirituality gets you to a nice place. That's the way. I was like, no. And I tried to tell them, no. And spiritual people got really mad with me. Nowadays, they don't get so mad because I say it in a nicer way. Maybe they don't, maybe say, oh, he's older, I don't want to hurt his feelings. But when I was young, the people got very upset with me, spiritual people. They said, nah, you're really way off track, and you're very arrogant to say these things to us. Who are you? You don't know this stuff. You're some egotistical, arrogant egotist to say this, that spirituality is off track. That's the ego, they said. You're off track. And I said, no. This is dualistic. And so it turns out that I was right. Now I see that I was absolutely right. It's a shame, that it's been 50 years of hell, of struggling to say who's right. I'm not sure who's right, but I was right. I was absolutely right. That spirituality is just the ego. It's just the ego. So is materiality. And this is what we don't see. We think there's some difference between the two. And we struggle, as Jesus says, we're trying to see differences in illusions, where he says there is none. We see differences where there are none, and no differences where there are. We see differences where there are no differences, and no differences where there are differences. In other words, we don't see differences between illusion and truth, but we do see differences within illusion. And Jesus says this is completely backwards. That there's no difference in illusion. Yet there is a difference between illusion and truth, for sure. One is true, the other is not. So maybe you have the same kind of feeling like, hey, I feel like this world and the education and spirituality, it's all somehow misleading me. Like it's leading me away from what I really want. Well, that's why you're here. That's why we're here. Because it's true. It's absolutely true. And we're on to it now. We're on to it. The Dharma Kings have our back now. They've made it very clear. We're not going to leave you until we bring you on home, out of this ridiculous delusion. I asked him not to leave me. I said, you stay on my case here now. Reel me in. You got to stay on my case. You can't let me slip off the hook. And they say, we won't. You're hooked. I say, good. That's great. You want to be hooked by the Dharma King. They're the great fishermen, right? And they reel you in. So so you might not be able to, what's being said here, it may lose focus on it, it drifts away, yeah, it does. But what you can get is sort of a confidence and a trust out of all this, a confidence and a trust. That's what's really important, because you have to trust your path. You have to trust the path of clarity, that you can see what needs to be seen. You have to trust that you're capable of seeing what needs to be seen. And I just read a quote by Rama. It's amazing, just before we did this video, that this picture of Rama, Facebook/Ramaharshi, this picture popped up in a quote of Rama, and he said exactly what we're talking about here. It was just really extraordinary. I just said, oh my gosh. Crystal clear what he's saying. It's exactly what we're saying. And he says, when you see this, The image will dissolve, and there'll only be intrinsic spaciousness left. That's all that'll be left. The image will dissolve. The false self will dissolve. When you see the false self is just an image, when you see that. It's an image of the self. When you see the image of the self is just an image of the self. It's the I is just an image of the self. I stands for image. So the I, the image of the self, is just an image. It's not the self. And it's the same as all other images. There's no difference at all. All images are the same in okay. In being an image. When you see that, he says, then the image, this image will dissolve and there will only be the true self. That's exactly what he said. And this is exactly what where I'm at and seeing this, it's just wow. I saw it's just an image. So we're trying to reach, spirituality is trying to reach the image of a self. Try to attain to the image of a self. That's spirituality. As Nisargadatta Maharaj says, he says spiritual. He says I have absolutely no use for spirituality, any more so than I have use for dishwater, old dishwater. Nothing whatsoever. He says, yeah, in his typical wonderful way, which I love. It's very honestly direct. You know, he's not trying to fool anybody with the slyness or anything. He just says I have absolutely no use for spirituality any more than so than I have old dirty dishwater. Because spirituality is an attempt to reach the image of a self and believe that that's the goal, the image of a self, not realizing it's just an image. So drop your spirituality, you see, or see that that's just an image. Now just wow this, just wow this. Don't do anything about it, just wow it. Just hearing this is a big wow. It's a very big wow. Now don't try, run out and try to do it. First you hear all this and you keep wowing it, and then at just some moment, just like I did, I said these affirmations, and I suddenly began feeling this reaction in my body, in my psyche, my overall psyche. Suddenly a reaction arose. I said, wow, let me pay attention to this. This is really quite strong. And it just felt like all these little adjustments kind of just pulsations and reverberations that just subtle little. I said, wow, there's a lot of commotion going on. So I closed my eyes, just felt like closing my eyes and just paid attention. Just sort of abided in whatever was happening and wowed it. Just sort of like you're rafting down a river. You know, you just sort of, okay, I'm just rafting down a river now. And there's some current, you know, and there's some little ripples and little chop and you know, up and down the river. Let's just raft down the river. Okay, fine. So I just rafting down the river, see where it goes. That's all. I just said, let's raft down this river and see where it goes. Feels like there's really a strong current, like I was being along a current of a river almost. You could almost feel, you know, it's like, wow, okay, something's really strong. So it'll just happen for you that way. It doesn't tend to happen for you when you're directly trying to reach it. It seems like when you do affirmations, it can just suddenly just go into it. You're just there. You're in this current, and then this current just sort of. It began to dawn, as if you're traveling towards the dawn in this current, and then. As you travel on this river, it seems to get closer to the dawn, and then you begin to see this dawning of intrinsic spaciousness. You begin to feel, oh, so that's mind. That's the true nature of mind. Like that, but the first step is this. Wowing of it. Actually, the first step, according to Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, is brahmachari, which is purity in deed and in action. Purify your life. She said everyone has to start there. And in hindsight, looking back, I see she's right. You really have to purify your life first. Then you listen and do the full stop on the wow practice, where you walk together in the wow of assertions, the wow, flipping the script. You do that. And then, once you get very good at that and very comfortable and familiar with that, you will begin to experience, go into this dawning of intrinsic spaciousness. It will just sort of begin to dawn like that. And you just wow that, you just wow it. And you begin to see this key insight that Ramana talks about, that they all talk about, but Ramana is very clear about this. When you see the false self. It's just an image of the self. It's just nothing that, but that. And that too is just abiding within the self. Then it will just dissolve on its own. He says it just self-dissolves. You don't have to do anything for it to dissolve. It will just dissolve, and that's it. Now, if you want to come back, it will seem that something's happening to the experience that you're having, but it's not. You've immediately superimposed an image, and all that's happening is is changing imagery. Something's happening to the within that image, but nothing's happening to the self, to intrinsic spaciousness at all. The self is Rana's term for intrinsic spaciousness, you might say, and vice versa. Tibetan Buddhists tend to use the term intrinsic spaciousness like that. So the brahmachari is to really clean up your life. It's very important you So that is a good step. Some of the yoga, a lot of the yoga, you might say, is just doing that. But they also think that, you know, that it's they're getting this spirituality, but just realize that's just the first step. Clean up your thinking, your thoughts. Don't let your thoughts stray to physical, the world. Don't, you know, no stimulants, you know, in your, I say no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. Purify your mind and your life of all of that, and don't focus on the special relationship at all. Don't focus on bodies and people and animals and all that. Turn towards spiritual discourse and clarification and graphics and imagery and all that, and just immerse yourself more and more and more in that, and try to live this very disciplined, austere life. You know, eat well, and don't, you know, cut out the heavy meats and you know, stuff like that. And you know, I've been vegetarian for most of my life, almost all of my life vegetarian, and more recently more like a heavy on fruitarian and just liquid diet kind of thing, and you know, just sort of lightening up that whole thing, and don't allow your mind to stray into fantasy. Don't be involved in a lot of contestment and controversy and argumentation. Keep your minds kind of calm and smooth. Stay self-composed. Keep your self-composure. All these good things are religion. That's called brahmachari. That's the first step. So religion is the first step. You become very conservative, so to speak, in your habits. It's very, very erring on the side of caution. Conservatism is like erring on the side of caution. Whereas those who don't do that, they think they're much more hip. They say, well, I can handle this. Those are not brahmacharis. Brahmacharis are cautious. They are on the side of caution. They say, I better not do that. I better not go to that bar tonight. Well, I suppose the big deal is have a couple beers, that's all. I say, no. Right now I'm not really into beer, you know. Cigarettes or, you know, stuff. So you cut out the cigarettes and the alcohol and the caffeine and you know, the drugs, and you try to live a real clean life, including all your thoughts. Any thoughts that arise, impure thoughts, you cut them out. Aggressive thoughts and stuff that, you know, that's just not right, you got to squish them right away. Say no. Just wow it. Go right into the wow. Don't struggle with them. Just wow it. Wow, I caught that one. Wow, I caught that one. And so you begin to discipline your mind. So you live a disciplined life. This is the first step, actually. But it's key. It's the key step. Without that, you won't succeed. Very key step. Secondly, then you begin to go into affirmations and assertions, and you begin glimpsing clarity and wowing it, and you begin to manage your success. You begin to have rapid success. And then finally, Sri Sri Anand Mahima said, the true light, the true self will begin to dawn upon you, more and more and more dawn upon you. And she says there comes a point where it's all there is, and the false self, you know, dissolves, and then you are in this radiant, blissful condition. And she says, you absolutely, you will reach that. This is how it goes. This is how it goes. She's, you know, perfectly aware of how it actually goes for us and how we're to be liberated. She was always in this perfectly blissful condition. I can feel it now. And I saw a picture of her just after this experience I had. I went in, I saw her picture. Look, I went to Facebook, and one of the members, one of my friends on Facebook, had posted this picture. I'd never seen it before. It's the best picture I've ever seen of her. I thought I'd seen it all. This is the best, and it just struck me like lightning. And I could see, I knew exactly why she was, what she was experiencing, which is what I just experienced in this meditation, this contemplative state I went into. It's exactly what she was experiencing. She's experiencing it all the time. I said, "Oh, so now I know, you know, why you feel so that way, why your countenance is that way." I said, "Ah, yeah, wow, beautiful, wonderful. Oh, wow, just super, 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 super." Now she's a real stickler for brahmachari, very strict, very understanding, but very strict. Says you gotta do better. And she's right. She's right. She's been very severe with me. Very severe. I felt like, wow, you know, it's too severe, too severe. Wow. Now, very severe. It's important that you get to this wow reaction and nothing else. You don't go into any imagery, fantasy, thinking, and concepts. It's just stick with the wow and just stay with this, like this neutral observer. And so you can see that it's an image. This false self, it's an image. You have to see it, you have to catch it. It's very quick, difficult to catch. It's like almost like catching your shadow. Yeah. And then it will just self-dissolve. You don't have to do anything other than catch it and see it, recognize it. It will dissolve on its own. This is what we're told. So don't try to do anything to it. Just see it. Just catch it. Just observe it. Be aware of it. And not in an intellectual way. Just in a wow way, like wow. And I caught it, you know. I lived through the experience, and then later next day, I became aware of this is likely what happened now. I said, "Oh wow, I superimposed an image of intrinsic spaciousness." Oh my gosh, yeah, it was just instantly right. The mind just boom. I decided to come out of it, and just you know, simultaneously with the desire, so it was a superimposition. But it is catchable. We can be aware of this, actually. I gotta diet more. I've gotten kind of off my diet. It's summertime. It's something about summer. I want to eat macaroni salad and pasta, cold pasta salads or something. And I start eating too much. I don't know what it is. It's interesting. Kind of feel like you want to be lazy in the summertime and just enjoy the heat of the, so I have to crack the whip again. I don't know. Oh, I like salty stuff in the summertime, so eating salty snacks, and that puts the weight on. Snacks to me just put the weight on. So some people's hair they grows really fast, and they say, well, all the food goes into growing my hair. And for me, my hair grows very slow. Because I have such a slow metabolism that my, you know, fingernails, my hair, everything grows very slowly. Maybe I'm trying to slow down aging by having a slow metabolism. And yeah, right. But it didn't slow down suffering, I'll tell you that. Probably did slow down aging. Probably did slow down, like a tortoise. The slow metabolism tend to live longer. Those are real fast metabolisms. They don't live as long. So I was still working out. The Holy Spirit said, take it easy on your legs today. They're getting tired or something. So I said, oh, okay. But I did, upper body workout. I did quite a bit, actually. Quite a bit. And my flexibility is getting, turning. I can turn 90 degrees completely. If you're lying this way, I can go all the way, align with this shoulder all the way to and the other side. It's really quite amazing. They're getting really, really good flexibility. And but I have to keep we got to keep our good habits going. So you wow these great insights and experiences, but you keep your good habits going. I'd say, okay, what did I drink today? I got some. I suddenly figured out something. I get some old bargain fruit and stuff that's super ripe and it's kind of almost overripe and it's not going to last at all. I just go home and I juice it, make a smoothie out of it. I guess a papaya is made of a papaya smoothie, two papayas, a smoothie. Clean them all. Got all the fruit out of the papaya, and then just juiced them up. With some also for some exotic fruit vegetable juice that they're selling that's like $4 a bottle as they discounted it for like $1.25 or something. I said, let me try this because it's a real yuppie, techie health nut thing. I never tried it. It's $4.25 for a little bottle. Come on. So I tried it. It's good. So I just used that to mix in with the papaya, and it tasted great. Great papaya smoothie. And then it was getting kind of a little bit lower, and I said, ah, let me mix something else in with this. It's kind of extended. So I poured in an Odwalla chocolate protein drink and mixed that up. Oh, wow, does that taste good? Papaya and chocolate protein drink? Awesome smoothie. But then again, I'm drinking too much of it. Yeah, I want to drink all this good, healthy stuff, but you can overdo it, right? So, some of the friends on Facebook, I just confirm everybody now. I just say, Holy Spirit's up to you. I mean, I don't understand why I get friend requests from some people. I really don't. Because I look and I just say, what? This is the, what does this have to do with what I'm saying? Nothing. I can't understand it. So I just say, what the heck? Let the Holy Spirit, I trust the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit, for some reason, it wants me to look at this stuff that they're posting. And but some post some really good stuff and some are into health food, which is okay. I get some health tips from it. It's got interesting health tips. Again, why not be into healthy living? That's brahmachari. It's part of brahmachari. It's a first step. And so we might as well be. We might as well be. Cucumbers, juice cucumbers. Okay, I haven't tried that one. I'm gonna try that one. And drink, and they say drink green juice. This is best for you. Well, they're probably right about that. Oh, I got a bunch of old nectarines. I gotta juice those up tonight. I'm gonna have nectarine smoothie. Nectarine smoothie. Whole case of nectarines. Cheap. It's like, wow. Okay, that's my uncle used to do. He get stuff that was a bargain, and then juice it up and eat it. And it was like, yes, yeah, but he was a super healthy guy. So he was a brahmachari, my uncle. A very, 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 very refined brahmachari, actually, my uncle. As was my dad. But my uncle was really, his brahmachari was so extreme that his character was positively affected by it. He was just a super health nut and did everything, that tried to be this uber brahmachari. His life, his thinking, his habits were just immaculate. Immaculate brahmachari habits, my uncle. And so I'd like to spend time with him. And I picked up this stuff and picked up what was he doing, and just kind of I felt like he's a very positive influence. But he hadn't gone beyond the brahmachari so much. He was so my dad went beyond the brahmachari into much more extreme, tremendous consideration, into more of the wow phase of it, but not really knowing how to manage the wow enough. So not exactly sure what so the what the what wasn't quite focused enough, the wow and the discipline, but he was definitely in that phase. He is brahmachari and then the wow phase of seeking wow experiences, trying to find the dawning of something, the dawning of the self, trying to find like that. So he was very much into that. along with being a brahmachari and very good habits and super disciplined. That was my dad. So I picked up on all of that. But my whole point to the brahmacharis and to the wowers was the whole spiritual path, that itself is the delusion. No path is the path. This is what Krishnamurti was trying to point out to us, actually. Here in California and here in the West, he came to the West and helped us out a lot, Krishnamurti. He is super helpful, actually. Because we say, what is he talking about? But he was a very good brahmachari, Krishnamurti. Very disciplined, neat, clean, his habits, super brahmachari. And he was able then to see that this false self is just an image of the self, and we're taking it to be true, and we're pursuing realization of that image as if that were enlightenment. This is the mistake we're making. So he really helped the West, Krishnamurti. He's one of our associates here. Okay. He's one of our associates. Very, very much an associate we have. I did meet him in my dream one time. I didn't meet him while he was in Ojai, California, because I was kind of ticked off at the whole spiritual scene because they rejected what I had to say. So I just kind of went into a shell, like, wow, the world doesn't want to hear what I have to say. They're all against me. And they are. They still are. They still are. They're very much against the truth that the spiritual people and the spiritual materialists and spiritualists are very much insisting that no, they know the way, they know the answer, but they're just clinging to an image, of the self, thinking that if they just embrace the image enough, that this is it. And really, unfortunately, this actually makes things worse, because keep in mind, the ego's prime key belief is that if we're all miserable, then there's no more misery. And this is its goal for us. Let's all be miserable, and then magically, let's say, misery will dissolve. It's like the anti-enlightenment. When we see that the self we've been pursuing is just an image of the self, then it will dissolve. So the ego thinks, so if you see something clearly, it'll dissolve. No, only lies will dissolve when you see it clearly. But the ego thinks that when we all see truth as in certain perspective, that illusions are true and truth is illusion, that the truth will dissolve and disappear, and then no more misery, no more continuity for your problem. So the ego has it completely backwards, but it will seem like you're on a powerful spiritual path when you follow the ego, because it still has this principle of like, well, don't worry, when you see it clearly, it will dissolve. But it thinks that truth will dissolve. When you see that the image is true, then truth itself will dissolve, and then there's no more misery from wanting truth. He said, well, the truth will be disappears. How can there be misery and wanting it anymore? It doesn't exist. It's not there anymore. And then you'll be happy. So this is what the ego believes. This is what our arrogance is telling us. And so when you follow materiality and spirituality, you're actually making things worse for yourself and for everyone, and headed downhill. You're on a slippery slope towards ultimately mental chaos. Depression, mental illness, all of that. Trying to romance the image of the self, in some way, try to find the happiness with an image. Yeah. Don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry here. Don't be too much of a hurry to race away from the profound. At some point, we will go on, okay, here, but don't be in too much of a hurry. Even if you feel like, okay, we've kind of heard what I need to hear. The key is to stick with it a little longer. In this whole path of hearing properly, you really have to be patient. This is what my dad lacked. He was in too much of a hurry to be a teacher. He says, "Well, I'm really good at brahmachari, and I've got some spiritual insight, so I can really help people be a teacher." But he was in too much of a hurry to be a teacher, and wasn't patient enough. This is the trouble, that those who fail to reach realization, they fail because they lack patience. They lack this desperate determination, which says, if I got to be patient, I'm going to sit here. If I don't care how long I have to sit here, I'm going to sit here. If it takes 10 hours, I'm going to sit here. Well, it's not going to take 10, but we're so in my life, I have to say, I always went to always go the extra mile. Always have. If something has to be done, it's like if I'm practicing something, I'll say, okay, I think I've practiced enough. And I'll say, okay, it probably is enough. But just let's err on the side of caution here and let's practice for another half an hour or so. Always that way. So err on the side of caution. So I don't want to, at the end of my life, I don't want to say that I didn't put in enough effort, that I failed because of a lack of effort, a laziness. I said that if I fail, I don't want it to be because of that. Because then, because that's under my control, right? It is under our control. We have the will to be patient, don't we? We certainly do. And I find that the failing of people in the world is they're too impatient. They're not willing to spend a little extra time. They say, no, something else is more important. I need to go, do this. I say, whoa, 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 whoa. If I get to that, okay. But first, I got to really spend a little more time here, and then I'll get to that. So, I end up, not getting to a lot of stuff that other people get to, which gives them a lifestyle, so to speak. That's true. I don't really, my lifestyle is this consideration here. That's my lifestyle. And I don't get to a lot of other stuff that they got to. But at the end of their life, they won't be enlightened, and they'll say, "Why? Why did I fail?" And they will realize, I didn't put enough effort into it. I didn't put enough time and effort into it." But they'll say, "Wow." So I don't want to have that realization. I failed because of that. This would be a life, wasted life then, in my opinion. I've already done so much in existence, and in this continuous continuum of misery is really just a misery continuum. A continuous misery is all it is. If we're not enlightened, our misery just continues. That's all it does. It just continues on until we're enlightened, and it dissolves. The whole image of a self, the I, the image self, dissolves. Until that happens, we're just continuous misery. Whether it be in a body or in an afterlife, it's still continuous misery. It really is. That's all you can say about it. So I don't want to continue with misery because I didn't make enough effort to get free of it. That's just, waste. What a waste. What a waste. What a waste. That's just regret. Be angry with yourself. Really furious. Like, what did I do? What was it that was so important that I wasted my life. So, I stopped watching sports. I stopped radio, sport, everything. I just boycotted the whole world. And now I'm just focused entirely on this because I'm nearing 60 and I realize, wow, it's possible that I might fail. And that'll be catastrophic for me. So I got to give it everything I got right now. I can't fail. I can't fail, to realize the truth. I this is my goal. So if I fail, it's because I wasted my time on other stuff that was not important. So you really look at the steps. The brahmachari, you try to live a disciplined, pure life, and cut out all the bad stuff out of your life. Really have good habits. Really good habits. Got to. It's a discipline. You're in control of that. You can do that. And then you start studying spiritual books and insights and seminars and meet gurus and go around and get this start getting a lot of wow in your life. But then you have to manage that properly, and you have to be really patient with it. very determined and patient with it. That's the key to success there. And then when you're that way, then it begins to dawn upon you, you know, and then you have to manage that success and accept some responsibility. You become aware of the Dharma Kings, they actually contact you, and you start entering into their service. And then that puts responsibility on you, you know, right? I mean, you really have to mind your P's and Q's then. You don't want to mess up. So you become very focused, you know, very focused. And for me, I knocked out all my stuff that I like doing in life. You know, I said, hey, not now. Not right now. It is too important. And you begin to speak up, you know, in the right way, saying the right stuff that needs to be said. And if you start teaching, you start teaching in the right way, which is very profound. It's not the typical kind of teaching that you see. It's not spirituality. You say right off the bat, spirituality is just junk. It actually makes things worse for you. It's just the ego. It's just the ego. So telling you that pursuing an image of the self is the answer. So the right way is to be very pure brahmachari, very pure in your habits, and then practice meditation and practice sitting quietly, full stop on the wow, silent meditation. Practice hearing without speaking much. Well, the way to do it is to be a great listener and hearer. This is what I was for like 40 years. I mean, most of my life, after nobody listened to me, then I just spent time listening to the Dharma Kings and the best teaching I could find. I didn't speak at all to anybody, really. I went years and decades. I didn't say anything. I didn't socialize. I didn't say anything to anyone. No conversations at all. I just listened. So I became an extremely good listener. Someone once told me that I'm the best listener they've ever experienced. It's just extraordinary. So you have to listen. Don't ask questions. Don't talk. Don't ask questions. Just listen and be quiet and get used to internalizing what you're hearing and wowing it and be patient with it. Just allow the wow to arise. So you're just hearing the truth, allowing the wow to arise and then patiently allowing it to subside. This is the best practice. You call it meditation if you want to. So those are the good habits. Those are the habits that will be successful. Very good habits. So you have these very good habits. Some of the people have these very good habits. So some of the friends on Facebook I see, I look, I say, ah, they do have these, they have very good habits. I say, oh, you know, this is good. I saw one friend asked for a friend request. I told him, I said, you're going to be a guru pretty soon, actually. I can see it right away. I can see it. I just looking at your picture, it says, you're going to be a guru. And indeed, what he likes, you know, is very much powerful, the best stuff. He's getting more and more comfortable with it, you know, and you can tell by what people like, you know, their likes that they like and share, where their attention is. And I can see, you know, that for this person, they're going to be enlightened pretty soon, actually. This is how I see it. Yeah, maybe not, you know, immediately, but it's coming. It's coming. But it takes a while. It takes a while. People said the same with me. You got a lot of potential. Yeah, yeah. Thanks. Yeah, that was how long ago? If, you know, 15, 20 years ago, they said, oh, you got a lot of potential. I said, yeah, I'm almost there. Yeah, I've always been almost there. Yeah, always been almost there. But Just like I work it out, you think it takes so long, you don't really get much benefit, but you get a little stronger, and it's that little bit more of strength that's key. That little more intrepidness to see that it's all an image, the self that we've been pursuing is just an image. The ability to see that, it doesn't seem like a much more of a big deal. It just a little more, but that's that little more, that's the hardest part. And many, come up short and they stall out. They stall out and don't quite get there. It's quite difficult to keep going because you think, well, what's the big deal? It's not just a little bit more clarity. And the ego tricks us here. This is maybe the ego's one of its main final tricks is to say, well, look, it's just a little bit more. You're almost there, right? And you say, well, yeah, well, what's the big deal that you don't really have to try that hard? I mean, you'll get it. You got plenty of time in your life to get it. And you say, huh? And the ego says, well, if it's such a little amount, probably easy for you. So I mean, you don't really need to do it right this moment, do you? No. It's a, it talk it psychs you out. It talks you into thinking, well, I don't really need to work at it that hard because yeah, I'm almost there. And it's not that much difficult and not much further to go. And you start getting lazy. So the ego talks you into being lazy. That's its key defense. So whatever you're getting lazy, the ego's is tricking you. This little bit more is where all the difficulty is. Because this is the where the ego makes its final stand into tricking us and deceiving us with spirituality. So this is where all the trickiness, the ego's trickiness, it's all that's a little bit more. So it's real difficult to get that little more progress. It's very difficult. And you have to be super patient. I mean, that's why they say only, Ramana said, only the very persistently determined ones succeed. You have to be very, very determined and persistent in order to succeed. You have to be. And this is, I say, I can see this is very true. You don't, I always say that the best practice is everyday practice. This is one of my aphorisms. The very best practice is everyday practice. You can't beat that. It's unbeatable. And it's indispensable. It's indispensable. The best practice is everyday practice. And like my dad, he went around traveled all the world giving seminars and talks like he was a guru. Many people, thought he was a guru and took him to be a guru. He took himself to be a guru. Whereas I've spent my entire life just in the exact same place, just sitting here, listening patiently, looking at my mind and the reactions and just wowing it. So I haven't really gone anywhere, done anything in my life. But this is what it takes, actually, is you cannot constantly be traveling around and teaching like you're a guru unless you've actually have realized. And even then you might not do that. Ramana just went to Arunachal and stayed there the rest of his life. He didn't go anywhere, did he? Did Ramana travel all over the place? No, he didn't. Ananda Maima did, but she had this action guru aspect. She was able to do that, and that was what she came to do. Was able to do it flawlessly, but just all the traveling around, all that's very distracting, very distracting. And my dad told me before he passed on, he said, I asked him, and he said, yeah, all this traveling, everything, that's not it. That's just pursuing an image, it's within you, it's within you. And then I tried to tell him about the Dharma Kings, that they may return to this world, and he said, no, it's within you. He didn't understand that, but the Dharma Kings have returned to help us out, literally. Now, I don't know if they're in physical bodies, or they don't have to be, actually. They can project into our mind without having a physical body, but they're very much back. Biting Padmasambhava back is, wow. That's just, I haven't really got a grasp of that. I really, just wowing that is all I'm doing. Wow. That's calling in the heavy artillery right there. And we need to, don't we? The world is just, it's ready to hit, the tsunami of despair is about ready to hit. We need Guru Rinpoche in the house right now. You know, that's a drastic step to take, isn't it? Because whoa, what's that? Ah, just a minute. Can you wait? Can you just wow Guru Rinpoche for a minute, please? Do so. No emergency at all. Ridiculous. Could have waited for, you know, an hour. Nothing. Typical stuff. But it's helpful for us because it helped give me a focus of somebody promising something and then not coming through. So yeah, I'll do this. And then, oh no, I can't. What I found is people promise to make the right decision, and then when it gets right down to it, oh, they revert back to the bad decision. This is what I'm noticing in the world. So they think, yeah, I'm going to make it, but they wait till the end of their life, and then they don't quite make it. This is the ego. The ego tricks them. So the ego says, promise, and that's good. You're a good person, because you're promising to make it, right? Yeah, but they don't make it. They fail. Wow, this is actually problematical, but I'll have to work it out here. Wow. Let the Holy Spirit, let Guru Rinpoche deal with this. Let Guru Rinpoche deal with this. It'll work out. It'll be fine. Everything will be fine. Yeah, I already see. Okay. So never lose your cool. Just say, turn it over to the Dharma Kings and say, I got trust in you. You got my back. So I'm not going to break my own man. Well, something happened today that we had this big, big problem. Hospital bill, you know, I don't know what to do with it, and we can't pay it and all this stuff. And then finally I just had to ask for help and just got, you know, got the help like that. So it didn't interrupt, you know, my focus. I refuse to let my focus be interrupted by any problem. Say, well, whatever the problem is, I can't deal with it. That's up to you, Dharma Kings. You deal with it. You deal with it. So I just ignored the bill. You know, I ignored it. I couldn't pay it. Ignored it. So I'm too busy. You know, I'm not going to let anything pull me off track here. I refuse to let anything pull you off track, whatever it is. My cousin died. Yeah, okay. I spent some time in mourning, but I also taped and I stayed in right on track with all of it. I'm still, you know, in mourning, but yeah, I don't let anything though pull me away from the focus. And our other cousin is still in intensive care on a ventilator, and in real bad shape, sedated, and I refuse to stop. You know, so okay, I'd still have to continue this very important focus. No excuses. No excuses. No excuses. My dad was very good that way, you know, very, very high brahmachari. No excuses. He didn't let us make any excuses. No, there's no such thing as an excuse. And I was kind of mischievous as a child because I was angry, I was upset because people rejected me. You know, and I was kind of angry at the world, actually. You know, have been most of my life because, you know, everybody won't, no one will listen, and people, you know, said you're nuts, you know, you're talking about, and they just ignore you and isolate you. You know, that's not very endearing, right? It's not very, the world doesn't actually endear itself to you when it's like that, when you're trying to help them. So, Sang a little bit today, but mostly I taped as driving. I didn't sing much. I don't want to. My voice wasn't so good. But I got to get back to that a little bit more and press it a little bit. When the voice, you know, it's getting there. I don't know. You know, will it get there or not? I don't know. I'm not going to worry about it. I'll keep practicing, and just see what happens. That's all. Yeah, we all have potential. It's like saying, like, potentially I could get in great shape. Well, will I? You know, we all could potentially get in great shape, right? Well, do we do it? Well, every day I keep working at it. That's all I can say. You know, I don't know if I will succeed or not. Today I tried to do some more flexibility exercises. This evening I'm gonna try to do more abdomen, you know, work and, you know, core work. Keep working on the core. As the yoga girls really hit the core, don't they? They really work on the core. These Eastern European, you know, yoga girl athletes there, Eastern European, Russian stuff, wow. They're just obsessed with athletics there, aren't they? Reminds us of ancient times, with the yoga girls of ancient times. You know, they looked so athletic and stuff. Well, they were. They were. They're obsessed with fitness. Certain women and men tend to get obsessed with fitness, and when women get into it, they work on their core more than their muscles. Because men tend to work on building up strong shoulders and muscles. The women tend to work on their abdomen and thighs and hips and core, because of their body build, the way they are. And they tend to be light. Much lighter, body mass is much less than men, and sometimes they're real short and light, and they weigh 100 pounds or something, and they just, you know, work on their core. They could just, like, they're insane with how fit they are with their core, you know, and how they can walk and move, and they get into it, they get obsessed with it, really do. Athletics, women's athletics came out of Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, and they were using steroids, of course. And they had these training programs for women. They were just unbelievable. They're trained more heavily than the men, almost, right? I mean, this sort of radical feminism, tough yoga girl thing came from the communist countries, actually. Where women, they're very tough, very athletic. And use a lot of drugs to get that way too, and then they were beating everyone else around the world, just like we had, you know, very feminine women in the rest of the world, and here came these Amazons out of, you know, the communist bloc countries, that they were from day one, they were training in gymnasium and all these very intense to turn them into super women, you know, super athletic women. And the rest of the world just got beat by him terribly. And then the rest of the world said, oh my gosh, you know, we got to catch up. And so it's kind of like we got shamed into trying to, you know, catch up with them. And we kind of overdid it, actually, in a lot of ways. Women now have become overly obsessed with athletics, a lot of them. Very much so. And it's out of balance. They've lost the patience. The great pa you know, the gr patience is great virtue, actually. And so it's got really out of whack in the world. Men are under a lot of pressure to earn enough money so the women can have, you know, their nice house and shopping and everything they want in life, you know, to be happy. So men are constantly under tremendous pressure. Go, 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 go. So they don't have a lot of patience. So where's the patience in the world? It used to be women were the ones who had some virtues of patience, calm patience, you know. And this helped the family and the men. It helped society and culture. Now that's a gone. It's like gone with the wind. Women are very impatient now. And this is disaster because men are generally impatient from the whole history of them needing to really be active to get bring the bread home, feed the family. Come on, be the breadwinner. They can't just be sitting, you know, sitting here for 8 hours a day, you know. But for me, I've been able to do it. Very unusual. Very unusual. The circumstances were such that I was able to be taken care of and live a life like a hermit, renunciate hermit. And I did. So I have a super patience. But the women used to have a lot of patience, even some super patience. And so that is super important for culture. And this is what's vanished now. It's vanished, and it's a disaster. It will cause despair in the world. And they, a lot of it had to do with those Soviet countries, communistic countries. They're so materialistic. They saw no value in women's being patient. They tried to breed very aggressive, dominant, aggressive Amazon, go, materialistic women. And they did. They did. They really did. And they can be very nasty. Someone from the Eastern Bloc countries told me. I know some people from Eastern Bloc countries. They say the women are just horrible, vicious. These are way more vicious than the men. They're just terrible. I said, wow. And then I bumped into one. I found out he was right. That was scary. He's more vicious than any man I've ever met. It's like, wow, what the heck, you know? And that's, you know. And so this uber materialistic Amazon type woman comes from materialism, communism. And now they're trying to balance it out with spirituality. I say, wow, we're like kind of crazy, you know. We're like too materialistic, so let's kind of try see if we can become a little spiritualistic. And they get into psychic stuff, all this psychic stuff. Yoga girl spirituality. But underneath that, they're really these really, you know, vicious materialists, actually. They're trying to tone it down. And then in the rest of the world, a lot of women are maybe too spiritual in terms of you know, pursuing spirituality too much. And so they feel they need to become a little more materialistic. So they're trying to become more athletic, and they're always trying to go on races, and you know, just they're constantly busy trying to get themselves to be less patient, really, unfortunately. So the great virtue of feminine calm and patience has been lost in this world. Some Indian women still have it to some extent, but they're losing it too. There's some women that still have some of it, but it's almost gone, actually. Third world women, they don't have it anymore. They're very aggressive, materialistically aggressive now. So I bemoan this because it's crucial. Patience is crucial to not stall out as you go into this wow phase of your spiritual path. You've purified your life, disciplined it, now you go into the wow phase. The key is patience there. Determination requires great patience. And this has become a lost virtue in the world. Totally lost. And this means the world's going to fail. You can't succeed without great patience on the path. It's impossible. So you end up stalling out into spirituality and calling it good. I say capping the path with spirituality means embracing the image of a self and finding some way to embrace it in such a positive way that you feel okay, your misery's gone, your despair's gone. It doesn't disappear. It actually makes it worse. But you don't quite realize as you're desperately trying to embrace an image of the self, you feel like maybe, and it kicks the can of despair down the road. But then later on, it comes back and it bites you really bad. Someone once told me, a yoga girl once told me, I told her, you know, you got to wait. I mean, this is going to happen. I said, all this great Dharma King thing's going to happen. I know it will. And she says, well, you know, patience, that's my one weakness. I'm not able to be patient. At least she was honest. She knew her weakness. And so she, you know, ended up roaming, moment, roam, 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 roaming, roaming, roaming. And, you know, will be one of those who, spirituality, hoping that's enough. Hopefully she succeeds. She's very disciplined also. Brahmachari also. But you have to have the patience. Have to have, and this is where most fail. This is where most fail. It's just ill. It's will. It's determination. It says, I cannot fail. So if it takes patience, that's what it takes. Whatever it takes, that's what it takes. That's like getting in shape. If someone tells you got to run up the Empire State Building, you know that, then that's what you got to do. If you got to run stairs in some skyscraper, you know this is what you got to do. And what do you? And then you know, then you're there and you start doing it. And however tough it is, you say, well, I'll just have to tough it out until I can do it. There's no other way, so that's it. You don't feel sorry for yourself or anything. You just say, okay, I'm going to do it, and I'm not going to stop until I succeed. And Failure's not an option. It's not an option at all. This is what it takes. And so I'll just be patient until I work at it, until I succeed. If it takes a day, if it takes a year, if it takes 10 years, if it takes a lifetime, I'll still be working at it until I succeed. You have to have this sort of attitude. You cannot just be a spiritual butterfly forever, you know, and just keep flitting around and never settling into the path of the wow and settling into managing success. Because when you start settling in, you start having great success, and then you have to manage it. So it becomes very involved in managing your success and compounding it. You keep compounding your success, and then it compounds even more. And so you very rapidly are going towards realization, and you have to manage the wow of that. So, you know, it becomes, you can't just be this social spiritual butterfly, you know. It does that will, you'll come up short. So if you're just like hunkered down like a hermit, being very patient, this is very good, very great. And you might think, oh, I'm missing it, you know, all these gurus and everyone's going to see them. You're not missing it. You yourself will be the guru. Don't be a professional devotee. That's the loser's path. You yourself, you're on the path to being a guru. There's a different path. So you're listening and you're hearing and you're being patient with the wow. Because you will be a guru then. You will be associated with the Dharma King. And they'll bring you into guru status for sure. Once you agree and you have this inner accord and agreement, okay, I'm all in. You know, they agree to bring you to guru status. They agree. This is my belief, at least you would say. This is how I feel. This is what I believe in. This is what I trust in. And I take it seriously. I take that trust very seriously. What's more serious than that? And I put it on their shoulders, say, you know, it's your path now. It's up to you. You know, I put it all on your shoulders. So Longchenpa, what does he do? He calls in Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro. He says, okay, this is going to help you. And then he calls in Padmasambhava. Oh, wow. Okay, so he's pulling these strings. Pulls in Chanasaring Chodron. He pulls in a lot of stuff. He says, you know, he's using his assets here to help me out. So I'm just saying, okay. And I tell him, we must go past this try but fail at the end thing. We must break through that barrier. This is not, failure is not an option here. So you just have this determination, you know, really determination. And then you say, even that's not enough. I say, I put my determination in your hands, Longchenpa, because even with my great determination, I know the way things go is you still come up short. So I try to sit at the feet of the Dharma Kings. Just sit at their feet and just put it onto them. Say, you are now me. Okay, I don't exist. You are me. So, you know, whatever you experience, I'll experience. Your experiencing is now my experiencing. That's how I do it. I say, of myself, I know I'm going to fail. So what use am I ultimately at all? I'm a failure. Okay, so I present myself to you as a failure. So now my success is really up to you. It's not up to me anymore. They call that surrendering to the guru. So this is what I'm, you know, working on and growing it. You know, I planted the seed. I got to grow that. You know, you have to work on it. Surrendering to the guru is you realize that the way we are, our continuity fears that we will get real close and then fail. We'll make the right decisions, and then suddenly back off at the last second. And so you realize that this is the way everybody is. And so you just assume that, you know, you are also that way. Then you realize that, say, oh my gosh, if my own accord, I'll fail again. Say, no. You Longchampa, you're in charge now. It's your enlightenment, not mine. It's your enlightenment, not mine. Then he shows me Padmasambhava. Holy cow. He introduces me to Padmasambhava. Wow. That's a wow. I mean, that's just this. It's just a wow. 100% wow. Is good. Padmasambhava is 100% wow. That's all I can say. That's all I really can say. There's nothing else that needs to be said at all. Padmasambhava is like a paper mache cutout in front of pure spaciousness and pure light. Pure luminous mind. That's all it is, just a paper mache cutout. There's nothing else there other than that. There's no body there. There's no person there. There's nothing there. It's just paper mache cutout. Paper cutout is all it is, really. A very flimsy cutout. Got some white pants today. Very cool. Blue collar chic. You know, painter's pants. Cheap. But very durable, very strong, very well made. You know, working man's clothes. And a few women at work as painters, I see a few occasionally. They're all business. They're all work. Tough, you know. Few. So this is, they don't make women's painter pants. It's maybe you have to special order them because there's not that many. So these are men's pants, you know, but this is cheap. And it's this beautiful, total white color. So I just said, I'm going to get a pair. I got a pair of white shorts, got a pair of white pants. $20 for like a super strong pair of work pants. If you just wear them for like what I do, just talking about, they'll last you like, you know, long, long time. 5 years, I don't know, long time. Eventually they get dirty, white gets dirty. But you can get another pair for $20. You don't have to, you know, buy real expensive pants. I just said it. So it's... Yeah, I'm going, you know, working class chic. Working class spiritual chic here. Throw the yoga girls a curveball here. And the yoga guys, but mostly yoga girls, let's be honest. You see these teachers right now, and I just noticed a teacher, very popular teacher now, rising star, so to speak, that which I don't, you know, I don't follow him. I don't subscribe or follow him. Anyway, he's a big gathering, picture of a gathering, and I see a couple guys, and they say, wait a minute, let me take a closer look at this picture. Oh my gosh. He goes, of course, it's like 80 to 90% yoga girls, of course. Same thing with all these spiritual teachers. It's about 90%, 80 90% women, yoga girls there. Yoga women, yoga, I call them yoga girls because this seems to fit, you know, and it's all chic, you know, yoga chic, yoga girls chic. They're all chiced out, yoga girls chiced out, but cleverly. It's part of the camouflage, you know, it's part of the deal, right? It's like, I'm going to fail on the path, but I don't want you to know about it. And they get a kick out of that, you know, there's an ego trip. It's an ego trip. Spirituality is an ego trip. Got to just be very clear. Spirituality is an ego trip, and it's basically saying, how well can I deceive you, teacher, into thinking I'm going to succeed? And if you think the teacher believes that you're really going to make it, you're really spiritual, then you get this real ego kick out of it. So that's the game they're playing. The yoga girl game they're playing is can I convince the teacher that I really am a really true devotee, you know, that I'm going to really succeed? Can I convince him? And that I'm not really just this professional devotee, you know. And they're always working to, does the teacher believe me now? Does the teacher believe me now? Maybe if I dress this way, maybe I act this way. Maybe if I meditate this way, maybe if I do this. And it's obvious what the game is they're playing. And it's an ego trip. But the yoga girls hate to be called on that. You know, it's like that's their whole life. So if you call them on that, so you're just camouflaging your you know, you're just faking it. You're not really, you know, that's like their whole life has collapsed. So generally, nobody calls them on it. That's the purpose of life, is to act like you're trying but not succeed. That's the ego. So we're all that way. So surrender to the guru is all that's necessary. Some women have done that. Some women have done that, but not many. It's very rare. Actually, because they think, no, if I'm just a little more chic and clever, the guru's going to think that I'm really it. And then I tricked him, ha, 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 ha. And they get this little ha, 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 ego kick out. It's like, ah, wow, I'm so clever. This is true, is it not? Every guru knows it. This is very true. And men, you know, tend not to be very as nearly as good as that. They're not nearly as sly or tricky with chic as the women are. This is just the way that the dream is. So they don't even try, basically. They just said, yeah, I'm an idiot. You know, probably won't make it, you know. But say, yeah, you won't. You probably won't the way you're doing. And they kind of shrug their shoulders and, you know, it's no big deal. They're not brittle about it. But if you tell a professional yoga girl devotee that they're not going to make it, they're just faking it, wow. You know, they're furious. You know, that just... It's like you've just attacked their ego, you know, just hideously. They like playing the game, a professional devotee. I'm seeing throughout history, and it's very clear to me this, and, you know, very few actually surrender to the guru. Very few. Same with the men, very few. But with the men, at least you can tell, hey, you know, you're not going to make it. And they say, yeah, I'm probably not. And why? Well, because you're lazy. You're not practicing hard enough. You're not, you say, oh, wow, okay. And they tend not to get furious about it, you know. So you can be more direct and honest with them. Not that gets them going anymore. So, but then they kind of drop out. Then, you know, they say, okay, well, I don't think I'm gonna make it. So they drop. So you don't see many men around gurus anymore in the world. You don't. I don't know if there's any more men left in the world. Actually, to tell you the truth, they're all kind of brittle now. But you see mostly yoga girls because the guru apparently doesn't tell them, hey, look, you know, your goal is just to be a professional devotee. You know, I know that's what it is. You're not going to make it with that at all. So you need to develop more patience. And, you know, and it used to be you could admonish women more because they were more patient. You see, now they don't have any more patience, so how can you admonish them? It's a trap, isn't it? It's really a very nasty trap. I wonder if some of these gurus are going to get trapped by that, because it used to just tell women, look, you know, you need to be more patient, you need to practice more, and you could admonish them. You know, go into a nunnery, spend the rest of your life in prayer and patience, and stick with it. And they might not do it, but they might, you know, accept what you had to say. You know, like the priest tells you this is, the priest still try to, you know, talk to women, set them straight to some extent. There's still some out there in the Catholic Church, but the rest of the world, gone. You cannot say that to the women without them feeling like you've like violated their sanctity of their ego or something, you know, their self-esteem. You attack their egoic self-esteem. So these gurus, so they don't drop out. The women, they don't drop out of the guru scene. And so it's like all the men are gone, right? Because they've dropped out because they realize that, you know, what they're doing just isn't going to make it. So why even bother? The guru maybe called them on it, but the women, they're not called on it, so they stick around, and think that they can fake it so artfully that they'll find true happiness in fooling the guru. You know, I fooled God, and that's my happiness. I fooled the grace of God. I'm smarter than they are. See? So that's the ego. I'm smarter than God. So they're trying to put one over on the teachers. There's no question about it. Now, are the teachers aware of that? Yes, I think they are. Most of them are. But in today's culture, what can you do? I don't know. Stop teaching? They can't get the men involved anymore because and most men are becoming very feminine anyway, but brittly feminine also. So you can't admonish them either. But they just feel like, deep down, they feel like, wow, there's something wrong with me. Something's wrong. Most men feeling that way. It's very interesting, isn't it? Very little real men left in the world now. Very few. It's a disappearing breed of the man. You can just be direct, talk like Sargodada Maharaj. Look how direct he talked. He was talking to men mostly. Just said, hey, just listen to what he says. This is the way people we talked. And the men would be like shocked and ashamed and like, but they just like take it. I was like, wow, okay. I need to do better. I'm not doing good enough. Okay, I got to work at it. Okay, he'd stun them. But nowadays, can you really talk to anybody that way? But this is just like, what was it 80? When did that book come out? 74. I Am That. I don't know. Was it like the 70s or was it early 80s? Maybe 79 or something. So he was talking to people that way in the 60s and the 70s and parts of some of the 80s. And then, and people would say, "Yeah, Maharaj." But then, now, I mean, wow. Can you do a Maharaj, Hammers of Maharaj right now? I don't know. I try to. I mean, I'm sort of like that way, actually. But I'm not talking to any people directly because I don't think anybody can handle that. I don't think the men can handle that anymore. The women certainly can't handle it. They're super brittle now. Their egoic image is so strong. It's, I'm smarter than God. So, I mean, who are you to tell me I can't succeed? I've already succeeded. I'm a super yoga girl, and I'm certainly going to succeed. I said, what do you mean you succeed? You're not enlightened. No, but there's no doubt I'm going to succeed whatsoever. So I might as well act like I have succeeded. And nobody can say otherwise. Well, that's having a lifestyle that way is a little bit different than practicing. I'm already there. It's different. We're practicing it because we realize that we're not, we're still hung up on that. We haven't clearly recognized that this is just a self-image. What they're really saying is, my self-image is all I need. It's great, and it'll make me happy. So I already have a perfect self-image, is what they're really saying. But what we're saying is, I've never been the self-image. I've never had it actually self-image. It's all a delusion. It's all an illusion. I've always been the true self. This is what we're saying. I've always been the true self. That's a different style of practice. It seems very similar, but it's actually completely different. As Ananda Mayamma would say, the emotionalism, the positive emotionalism of the ego has, it says in no way is that similar to bliss. In no way is it. In no way is it similar. You cannot equate the two in any way, she said. This is very important to hear this. So the yoga girls think that they just have the right self-image now. They fooled the guru. Now they got their super smart self-image, and this means that they're happy. They're great. Everything's great. And if you say anything otherwise, you're putting a bummer on them. You're attacking them. And so they're very brittle about that. But this happiness that spirituality brings you is in no way can you equate that with bliss of the true self. In no way. Entirely different. This just comes from the mouth of the Dharma King, Sri Sri Ananda Maimah. Take it to the bank. It's absolute gospel. So they maybe say, I already have happiness. Well, we're saying, I already have bliss. It's totally different. Totally different. So the practice may seem the same of assertions, I already have it, but it's what the content of what we say we already have, which is completely different, and in no way does it equate. So take this, hear this, wow it, take it close to to the core of your being, and keep it there and let it grow, this understanding, recognition. So don't get fooled by the fact that others are doing assertions and it seems what we're doing seems similar. I'm already there, I'm already that. But I'm already, I've always been completely blissful. I'm already blissful. I've always been blissful. I've never been not blissful. It's impossible for me to not be blissful. I'm completely blissful right now. And we're talking about the bliss of intrinsic spaciousness, that is the bliss that Sri Sri Anandamayi showed us, that Ram Maharshi showed us. We are talking about that. We're not talking about yoga girl, I outsmarted the guru, I'm on a ego high sort of happiness thing. We're not talking about that at all. Not in the slightest bit. So let us start getting familiar with not being confused in this area, because this is an area of great confusion, because ego makes sure that we're confused. It keeps promoting happiness. We're not promoting happiness here, we're promoting bliss. The super smoothed out intrinsic spaciousness, the superlative, infallible sameness, the superlative, infallible sameness of smooth, super smoothed out intrinsic spaciousness without another. You know, this is what we're talking about. We're talking about this, the presence of bliss. It's not a person being blissful. It is the presence of bliss. It's different. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, it wasn't a person there at all. It was the presence of bliss. And this presence of bliss extended for miles in her case. And you weren't meeting a person, you were meeting the presence of bliss. And when you look at her picture, you're not looking at a person. You're looking at the presence of bliss itself. And this is very wowish. You have to wow it. Sometimes it's too strong for me. I have to say, it's been an ordeal, because there's nothing to do except to wow. You have to really wow it. You can't be superficial and say, here's a nice mother, a nice person, and she's happy. No. That's not it at all. That's not it at all. This is the literal presence of bliss. Profound presence of bliss. Profound. And that's all it is. That's all it is. It's bliss speaking. It's bliss moving. It's not a body moving. It's bliss moving. There was no body there. It was just an appearance of bliss. That's all it was. It was the bliss body simply appearing here. Called Nirmanakaya, pure Nirmanakaya, but animated entirely by the bliss body. Dig that. And Padmasambhava may be the Dharmakaya body. Pure Dharmakaya body and nothing else. I mean, I don't know. It's just like, wow, you can't even have an image of him, basically. They just hold up this paper mache cutout figure, well, that's it. He was like just like the Dharmakaya body here, having just a flimsy bliss body. And seems to be, you know, it's like, wow. That's just a way of showing. Of course, not in my mouth, so it was pure Dharmakaya, pure bliss body. But she had a Nirmanakaya presence here, so she could move about here more and interact with us in a seemingly a normal fashion a lot more. Padmasambhava seemed to be more extraordinary. In fact, he seemed just to be, you know, wow. His physical presence here was a very doubtful in many ways, almost, right? That's why people say he was almost mythical. No, he's real. But his Nirmanakaya appearing here was, he would just disappear. I mean, and the way he left here was, he just turned into light. That's it. Same as Jesus did. So Jesus may have been a Dharmakaya appearance too. Very flimsy physical appearance here, actually. Very much so. That's just very difficult. They'd say, we don't know who you are. You know who I am? It's like, wow. His apostles are like, wow, I don't know. And Peter said, well, you're the Christ. And yeah, but he said, you don't really, you know, it's hard for you to relate, right? And yeah, it is. So Jesus and Padmasambhava may have been very similar in that regard, actually. Very similar. Looking at Padmasambhava is a different story. It's you're seeing the bliss body, but you're also seeing the Dharmakaya body, which is the wisdom body of the pure spaciousness body of just, you know, absolutely beyond the beyond. It's very strongly present in that statue of Padmasambhava, somehow you can feel it's very strongly present. It's the one that the Chinese destroyed, by the way. Communist Chinese, sorry. Not the ethnic Chinese. You know, I love the Chinese. The ethnic Chinese, they're wonderful people. The communist Chinese got this on an ego trip, unfortunately. And they're on this materialistic ego trip, which is the counterpart of a spiritualistic ego trip. Same thing. But they're on a very severe materialistic ego trip. So they destroyed this statue of Padmasambhava that apparently was made during his lifetime, and he said it looked just like him, you know. So it was a very powerful statue that's helped Tibetans greatly, and they destroyed it. But we have pictures of it. And they carry the grace too. They absolutely do. And we've got Padmasambhava coming back himself, you know, right now. See, apparently, this is what Longchenpa seems to be intimating. So, you know, dig that. He says, not so fast, ego tripping communist Chinese, not so fast here. Yeah, you're not done with me yet. You're not done with me yet. And again, let me emphasize, I love the Chinese people, the ethnic Chinese. They're very cool people, very smart. But they have a tendency to be overconfident. They're impatient. I think they've been very patient about history. I think they've run out of patience is the problem. Because that's coming up short. Because they didn't surrender to the guru. You know, at some point you have to surrender to the guru. Because you'll run out of patience. And the Chinese, culturally, I think they ran out of patience. And this is the problem now. Because they've been patient for thousands of years. I mean, they've great civilization, great history, great people, but they ran out of patience and culturally, and this is what communism took over, and this is bad news for the world, I'm telling you. They, you know, so they did not. You got to surrender to the guru. You got to surrender to the guru. At some point, you say, you know what? I think I'm going to fail again, and I don't want that. So I'm going to surrender to the guru, and it's your path now. I don't exist anymore. It's you are the existence for me. This works. And again, both men and women have done this. Surrender to the guru. This is, Ramana says that ultimately you have to surrender to the guru. And this is the final step. And then guru takes care of everything then. Everything. You have no more worries at all. You're in bliss. When you truly surrender to the guru. And of course, like everything Ramana says, it's true. Yeah, finding out everything he said, it says, is true. But it's so extraordinary what he says, you know. It's like, my whole life I'm thinking, is that true? Wow, I don't know. Wow, it seems so, but it is. It is. He's right. How are we doing here on this video? Oh my gosh. Did we hit the 2-hour mark again? I don't mean to do the videos 2 hours. But I just have this patience, right? And determination, so it just... Did I say, I just want to make sure we, you know, cover all the territory here. We got to cover this. This is really important information here. You know, we're talking about the Chinese and what their problem is. They lost their patience. They lost their cultural patience because they, and the Jewish people have also lost their cultural patience because they've been patient for 6,000 years. These old civilizations, they've lost their patience. You know, they didn't surrender the guru. Now they're ego tripping in certain ways. You have to say that. Yeah, I know it's not politically correct to say that, but they're on an ego trip, and they're wanting to control the world in various ways. You know, it's true. It's true. A lot of people are aware of this. There are various factions in the world that are vying for control. They just said they've had enough of this patience. To heck with it. And you know, when people have been very patient for a long time, finally lose their patience, they really go on a severe ego trip. So there are various factions in the world, again, who've lost their patience. Because they weren't willing to surrender the guru. they didn't have the wisdom and they weren't willing to do it. They just and very wonderful people. I love all of them. They're very wonderful. But when they lose their patience, they're not so wonderful. They can become very ogre-ish, you know, very terrible, actually. Very terrible. So there's no such thing here with us losing our patience. You don't lose your patience. You simply refuse to. That's a taboo. It's just, you cannot. Doesn't matter what, how frustrated you are. Your response to it is more patience. That's it. This is what I've had to do with my life. You know, just I felt like losing my patience a million times, right? Super frustrated. I've been unbelievably frustrated. But my response to it is patience. Just it's just will. Discipline of will to be patient. You just will yourself to be patient. Just sit quietly. It's the best practice you can do. You just will yourself to sit quietly and be patient. And, you know, we think, well, that's easy for women. No, it's not. Not anymore. It's not. Not anymore at all. Women have lost their patience. Actually, forgot that is the biggest faction of all in the world. The most danger, greatest danger in the world is women, because they've lost their patience. They said, look, we've been patient for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, and we still don't have it. You guys didn't bring home the bacon, you know, of enlightenment. Well, enlightenment's not something that the man can bring home for somebody. It's like saying, you know, you can't drink a glass of water for somebody and quench their thirst. You can show them how to drink water. You can lead a horse to water, but you still have to drink. And so the women haven't drunk in the water, and they've lost their patience. They say, you know, this doesn't work. And so that's the biggest faction in the world that has lost their patience is the women of the world. And this is the biggest danger of all, more dangerous than any of the other factions. Because when women lose their patience, they really go on the warpath. And boy, they don't listen to anything you say anymore. This is what I've discovered. You know, they're in charge now. Because I say, you guys, you didn't do it for us. I say, well, what do you mean? Plenty of men did it. They said, here's the water. You got to drink it. And it's your fault for not drinking it. You didn't surrender to the guru because you were on an ego trip and wanted to trick the guru, almost surrender, but not quite, and then say, you thought I was going to surrender. I tricked you. That's ego tripping. So it's your own fault. It's your own fault. Don't lose your patience. Why should you lose your patience? It's your fault. Those who lose their patience blame someone else. You never blame anyone else for the spiritual path. It's your own fault. You have to go back to being patient again. I'm saying this to everybody, but to women especially, you have to go back to being patient again. And that's what they don't want to hear. So, no. You know, that's the old feminine way. No, we're feminists. No, you have to. There's no choice about it whatsoever. You have to go back to being patient again and realize it was your own ego tripping was the problem. And you have to surrender to the guru, your own life to the Dharma kings. You know, not just some guru, but surrender to the Dharma kings, surrender to the grace of God. And it's your existence. You no longer exist at all. It's their existence now, not yours. And, you know, if you're not willing to do that, you have to be patient and keep working on the wow. Keep wowing this. Just like everybody else. You know, you're not special. Nobody's special on the path. But so women have lost their patience. And then men are basically buried because of this. Because when women lose their patience, and men don't know what to do, actually. They really don't know what to do, men. They're just wandering around like drones, you know, that can't get back to the hive. You see how they just wander aimlessly around? Like, I don't know what to do. I don't know which direction to go in. The men are like drones. You see them, these bees on the wandering around the ground. Those are the drones that can't go back to the hive. They're tired. They're wandering around aimlessly. They're just in a daze. Men are in a daze. It's unbelievable what's happened, really, with men. Because women lost their patience and blamed men for their failure. No one to blame but yourself. Everyone has to, their failures, our failure is our own failure. Nobody's responsible for enlightenment except us and the Dharma kings, and you have to turn it over to them eventually, ultimately. Otherwise, you're going to fail again and blame someone else and then lose your patience and go on the war path and start wars and, you know, all the hideousness that comes. And when women lose their patience globally as they have, you can expect extreme trouble to come, actually. Very extreme trouble. Because we've lost the patience, or there's no breaks anymore. The world doesn't have any more breaks, except the Dharma kings, only breaks we have right now. So don't ask me about this guru, that guru, that guru. Just ask me about your own patience and just work on that. And it's not servileness, it's full stop in the wow patience, meaning you're so buzzed with the glimpse of reality that you just gotta sit here patiently until the buzz wears down. That kind of patience. So positive patience. Not servile enslavement patience, that's nonsense. But positive patience, like, wow, I just got my bell rung so badly, I just gotta sit here for an hour or two. And then, oh, I got it rung again. I gotta sit here for another hour or two. So it seems like you're very submissive in the world, the submissive role. Yeah, my role is extremely submissive in the world, as far as like being on the bottom of the barrel, you know? I just seem like a little drone slave, you know, really. But really, it's because I'm wa positively wowing all this fantastic progress and breakthroughs I'm making. That's why. I'm really not submissive at all. I'm super adamant, like Nisargadatta Maharaj. I'm very adamant and fiery. But I appear to be, you know, just a, you know, severe loser in the bottom of the barrel because of I'm just patient with the wow. I'm always quiet. I'm always just trying to be humble. And, because I saw something, wow, I just saw an incredible breakthrough and insight, wow. So I play it cool, gotta underplay it, err on the side of caution, just act like an idiot, play the fool. So I've just played the fool my whole life. And most people think I'm, you know, just kind of a fool. A loser, you know, just a fool, a loser, not amount to anything. And then very rarely ask me, did you do something? What about, why should we ask him? He never does anything, you know, he's just a loser. I don't know how I like to think about me, but pretty much it's just a sort of do nothing, uninteresting, boring person. My life's been probably the most interesting life on the planet, you know, really, one of the most for sure. But most people think I've just led a, you know, a drab, humdrum, loser life. It just shows you appearances. Can't read a book by its cover exactly. Not really. A lot of time you can, but not always. Not always. Some people look at me and they say something isn't right here because you know you're just like a drab, boring loser. But something, you know, you're not really that at all. Someone saw that. Very acute man saw that. Very astute. He himself was kind of like that, like a loser, you know. But he was really sharp. I could tell. He's working at a really terrible job, and he saw me. He says, "Yeah, this doesn't add up. You know, your job you have and what I see in you doesn't add up at all. Something isn't right here. What's going on with you?" I say, "Well, yeah, you're right. You're onto something there." I didn't really explain it to him, but he saw it. A couple of people have seen it in my life. Not many, though, really. Not many. They just think I'm just an, you know, I don't know, just a the black sheep. Something was never going to amount to anything. Like you have to put up with this. You know, this is the patience, is that people think you're just a loser. But they don't, because they themselves don't have the patience, so they can't imagine that you have super patience. I mean, they just can't imagine it. I mean, who can imagine just spending your entire life just being sitting quietly, studying and reading and doing nothing else, just being a hermit? Who can imagine that? This is pretty much what I've done. They can't imagine that's possible. They just think I'm just a loser. They can't. They didn't. They don't know I've been studying. Nobody knows. I didn't tell anybody, because they'd sabotage it. They say, no, you got to be miserable like us, because that's the only way we get rid of misery. If everyone's miserable, that's the ego's belief that reality will vanish once they all believe in lies. That's what the belief. That's the bedrock fundamental premise the ego has, and so. They'd sabotage you if they find out you're practicing, constantly practicing like I am. I'm constantly 24/7 practicing, which is what Sri Sri Anandamayi said, in order to succeed, you have to ultimately be 24/7. And I am. I'm 24/7 now. And trying to be even more than that, really. You know, it's just more intense, more intense, more intense. And just, what else is there to do right now? Actually, the world's going to hell. I mean, it's what else is there to do? It's so silly. The world's so silly. It's caught up in silliness. Wow. Patience is profound. Patience is very profound. It's the best move anyone can ever make, is cultivating great patience and ability to listen and hear and be patient with what you're hearing and listening and wowing your reaction. It's the greatest skill there is in the world. It's the most profitable skill there is. Because ultimately it leads to recognizing that this is, we've all just been pursuing an image of the self. Existence is just an image. Existence is just an image. That's all it is. You know, wow, that. I have to wow that a little bit now, yeah, wow. That hit me hard. I feel it hitting me hard. Wow. Your body might kind of subtly, very subtly, not surface-wise quiver, but your nerves are kind of quivering. Let's put it that way. Body is not twitching or much or doing, no, it doesn't twitch or act anything out. But my nerves, I kind of feel like my nerves, deep nerves, are like quivering. It's kind of, you hear ringing, kind of hissing in your ears and ringing, and like, you know, really there's some inner intensity taking place. There's definitely a feeling on some inner intensity taking place. But superficially, no, there's no real signs. It might be a little bit of muscle twitching, but so subtle, you know, that it's not perceptible. Existence is just an image. That's all that it is. So I'm just being patient with it. See, this is what I do. Got to be patient. Okay, so the wow has arisen. I just got to be patient with it. I'm getting more muscular. Does that speed up my golf swing? No, it slows it down, actually. So Tiger Woods got too muscular. It slowed his swing. It slowed his swing down, his accuracy, his swing. It's better to be thin and wiry, you know, that kind of thing. Like young people are, like that's better. You have faster club head speed. So I'm letting this insight reverberate. It seems to be reverberating all over. Much the same as last night. Same experience. But this one, I'm not trying to go into any sort of dawning of intrinsic spaciousness right now. I'm just observing the reaction, the wowness of it. Existence is just an image. But I am keeping my eyes closed. It feels like when it hits you hard, there's a tendency to close your eyes. That's how people try to invoke it, by closing their eyes. I don't think that works. I think keep your eyes open until the wow hits, and then when the wow hits hard, really strong, just let the eyes close. This is how I've experienced it. really has nothing to do with close having your eyes closed at all. So you can't really cause it by keeping your eyes closed. It's not like that. It just feels like it's sort of like you're so relaxed in a psychic way, so that you don't really want to feel any need to look at the world. Open your eyes and look at the world. And a little moth just kind of went on my arm there. It's really weird. And I didn't even open my eyes to look. I just felt this, and I'm not opening my eyes. I don't even feel like opening my eyes. Interesting reaction. I don't really feel like moving either. And I'm kind of hunched over here, but I really don't feel like moving at all. It feels kind of weird to move. I don't. Interesting. It feels weird to move. It just feels like that's a weird thing to do. Moving your body. It's weird. It's a weird thing to have your eyes open. Having your eyes open, that's weird. It doesn't seem natural to this recognition. It doesn't seem natural to it. So sitting quietly like this seems more natural to it. So it may be that this image of existence is dissolving. This is maybe what's happening, sort of. It's sort of I'm letting go of existence, of the image. It's just an image. Letting go of this image in some way. Deep down, somehow I'm surrendering the image of existence. Giving it to the guru. I say, guru, here, it's yours. You give it to the guru. It's safe. It won't harm them. I say, this is very harmful to me, guru. Dharma King, but I know it won't harm you because you see it as abiding in intrinsic spaciousness equally with everything. So you take my image of existence. I don't need it. I don't want it anymore. So surrender your existence, surrender the quality, our life. It's really just an image. Surrender the existence is just an image. Surrender this image to the guru. What do Christians say? Give your life to Jesus. This is exactly what it means. Surrender your life to the Guru. Give your image of ex give the image we call existence to the Guru. Give it to Jesus. And many Christians have done this actually. This is being lost sight of now, but many have. But many Christian saints, many. Many have given their life to Jesus, truly they have. And he takes the image from you. And you're in bliss. You're a saint then. You're in bliss. And they work at it. They work at it. Just I'm working at it as well here right now. Giving my life to the Dharma Kings, giving my image of existence to the Dharma Kings. If there's one Dharma King that you might feel more comfortable doing that with, that's fine. You can do it to any one of them or all of them. Or you can practice doing it with all of them. You can practice with Jesus, practice Padmasambhava, practice Longchenpa, and Shishinad Maima, Ramaharshi, Jamyang Kenti Choki Lodro. Did I say Longchenpa? Yeah, all of them. You can practice. You can practice surrendering your existence image to them. The I, the existence image. Give it to them. Say, it's yours now. I'm giving this to you. Thank you for accepting it. They're the only ones that will truly accept it without insisting you keep some of it. See, that's the problem. If it's not a Dharma king, they may insist that you keep a little bit of that, you know, a little time, a little bit of that image, and that doesn't work. The Dharma kings will take it all. They'll take all of it. They see through all of it. They see it's just all of it's an image to them, which is totally an intrinsic spaciousness along with everything else. Buddha and sentient beings are all equally in intrinsic spaciousness. They see this perfectly. So they're not going to try to give you back some of it. So surrender to the Dharma kings. I hope this is still recording. Let me take a look. Yeah, it is. Oh, that's great. So we got all this on tape. Very powerful and very profound. Wow. Still very powerful and profound here for me. The tape is about ready to stop recording, so just be patient. Just be patient with all of this. Your patience is rewarded. It's patience is the water water the tree that bears the fruit. Patience is the water that waters that tree that bears the fruit. That is for sure. And we're showing just what patience, what kind of fruit it bears us. We stuck with it, and now we're getting this fruit. The fruit of the true path. Just in time. Very great. That's it for this one, huh? Yeah. Wow. I'm just sitting there. Don't really feel like moving.